Hi, this is Jose Luis here, and welcome to a new video on this series, Introduction to Parametric Modeling. In this one, I would like to make a super, super simple exercise where we're going to take an image and we're going to use the brightness of the pixels on that image as the values that are going to drive the diameter of all these circles so that we will be able to generate kind of a representation of my face using circles that are bigger or smaller. And of course, everything is going to be parametric, so we're going to be able to increase the resolution of how many circles we're using to represent this image so that it starts looking a little more defined, right? And I will show you as well a technique to use conditional statements inside of Grasshopper to remove, to add or remove elements. So in this case, for example, I'm going to implement a kind of cutoff where we're going to be looking at a level of the brightness, and I'm going to be removing circles for those pixels that are under that value of the brightness. This is going to be a super simple exercise. It's going to take us like six components to do, and it's going to be super nice because it could generate a pattern of circles that you could use, for example, for laser cutting or for etching or for creating stickers, or I don't know. That is absolutely up to you. Okay, but it's going to be super simple and super straightforward to do. Let's get done. And also, I mean, even if you don't want to learn how to do this, you can just take this file, replace your image there, and then just be done with it. You know, it's as simple as that. So let's get hands on and let's get started. This exercise is going to be so easy that I'm not even going to do any sketching on the whiteboard. And you already saw in the introduction what the exercise is going to look like. So I'm just going to cut to the chase and start writing code. So what I'm going to do is I have a couple of sliders here that I will use. And then I just dropped an image sampler from parameters input image sampler. I just dropped one here, which I'm going to extend to make a little bigger. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to double click and I'm going to load an image that I have here from myself, okay? Then, because in the previous exercise, in the previous video, we saw how by default, the domain of the image is from 0 to 1. This I can change, so I can make it, for example, from 1 to 10, so that the image, in a sense, is a little bigger here on the Rhino viewport, if you will, okay? And then what I can do as well is that I can choose from here, I can choose what is it that I want to output from the image sampler. So right now we have RGB colors, but I think because I'm going to create patterns of circles that open bigger or smaller, I'm not going to use the RGB colors. I'm just going to use the intensity. So how bright a particular pixel is going to be. And this will be a value of from 0 to 1, with 1 being super bright and 0 being not so bright. Okay. Do you see that the image sampler turns black and white? Because that's a more accurate representation of brightness, okay? And I'm going to plug in here a panel to get a sense of what's going on. Now, what I would like to do is I would like to create a grid of points that I'm going to use to sample this image. So what I need to do is I need to create a grid of points that go from 0, 0 to 10, 10 at however much intervals. And this is because the grid of points are going to be here physically in Rhino, but also it's important that those points have the same coordinate space than the image. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a grid of points that is going to be square, and then how many, the base plane is going to be fine, the size of the grid cell. So how many grids, how many points, how many elements are on each direction will depend on my number of cells. So for example, I'm going to do 10. And then the size of each cell will be equal to the size of the whole thing, which we agreed was going to be 10 units, divided by how many cells I have in each direction. So that's why I need to do a division where I'm going to divide the total size of the grid by the amount of elements, and that will give me the size of each one of the grid cells. And therefore, if I have more cells, then they are smaller, but if I have less cells, they are bigger. Okay, right on. Okay, so now I have here a collection of points Those points have coordinates in world coordinates, 0, 1, whatever, blah, blah, blah. But I don't care about world coordinates. I care about the domain space of those points is going to be similar to the one in the image. So what that means is that from 0 to 10, my image is also sampled from image from 0 to 10. And therefore, now each one of those points has a value for the brightness. So you can see that some points have low brightness and other points have high brightness, etc., etc. And what I can do now is I can use those values to drive the dimension of a particular element. So for example, I'm going to turn this off and I can use those to drive the dimension of a particular element, for example, a circle. And if I drop a circle here and I choose all these vertices as the centers, and if I choose all these radii as the diameters, you can see that something is happening. So I can see that more or less there is like a sense of larger circles around and smaller circles here. And if I crank this up, it looks like there is some kind of pattern arising here that looks like the image. So that is great, but you can see that because I'm using just the straight numbers 0 to 1 as the radii, then this is not working entirely. It's not working entirely because the circles should be smaller the more cells we have. So what we need to do is we need to multiply this 0 and 1 by the size of the cell so that the circle adapts to smaller cells or bigger cells. So I'm going to add here an expression, and this is going to be cell size, and this is going to be brightness, and then the cell size is going to be here, and then the brightness is going to be this one, and then I'm just going to multiply here the cell size multiplied by the brightness. And as I do that, I'm going to plug this in here. And it's starting to work, but you can see that there's overlaps. That's because we are using the radius, not the diameter. So we just need to multiply this by 0.5. And now you can see that, oh, now we're getting something that looks much better. All right. So we get larger circles where the area is brighter, and we get smaller circles where the area is dimmer, which could be a way to go as the pattern. And let me actually crank this up so that we have like a more definition. So this is starting to look pretty cool actually, but I would argue that perhaps, and even if we do like a planar surface, like a boundary surface, it's going to look even better. So it's going to look something like this, right? However, I would argue that I kind of want the opposite effect. I kind of want less or smaller circles where things are brighter, and I want bigger ones where the element is bigger. So I think what I would like to do here is I would like to say that perhaps what we want is 1 minus the value of this, or here 1 minus the value of brightness, so that wherever we have a lot of brightness, the value is very small, and wherever we have tiny brightness, the value is bigger. And then I can do that, and you can see that now this is starting to look a little better. Hold on. Is this looking good? And it's starting to look a little better. By the way, I never gave credit. This image was taken by my friend Nono Martinez Alonso. So it's always good to give credit. And something that I also want to try is if I can find I can implement something where under a certain radius, under a certain size of pixels, we're just not going to take that into consideration. So what I would like to do is if certain circles are smaller than a particular value, then just remove them completely from the list. So what I can do is I'm going to say here I have all the values that I have computed, correct? Or maybe I'm going to work directly here with the brightness, okay? So I'm going to take all the values for the brightness, and I'm going to check if the value of the brightness is over a particular threshold, or aka if the value is very, very bright. So how do I do that? I can go to mathematical operators, and I can use, for example, a comparison operator that is called larger than. With larger than, what I can do is I can compare if these values that are coming here are larger than a particular value. So for example, 0.9. And if I do that, then what the result of this is going to be, what the result of this is going to be is a list of true and false values that tell me whether if a particular number is greater or not than a particular one. And with this list, what I will be able to do is I will be able to remove from this data tree any element that is false and keep any element that is true. So for example, I'm going to use call pattern, and we have seen this one before, I think, where we take a list and we take the pattern used for calling, so a list of true and false values, and then the component removes those values from the list. So I'm going to take this list, the list of values, correct? I'm going to take that and I'm going to apply this pattern. And you can see that now the comparison is that what I have is only the values that are greater than this value. So I actually want the opposite effect. I want the ones that are smaller. So I'm going to repeat this, but with the other. So I'm going to repeat this and I'm going to repeat this. And now what I have kept is only the values that are smaller than a particular value. And then as I plug this in here, you can see that, oh no, what happened? We're having data problems here. All right. So what that means is that I need to call not just the numbers, but I also need to call the points that I'm using as the baselines for the circles. And that is going to be something like that here. And now you can see that the more I lift the limit, the more circles we get, but the least, exactly. And then if I go all the way up, then I get all the circles. But if I go to, for example, 0.8, like a lot of these bright values are starting to leave, you see? And I could also create an animation with this actually, but I'm going to leave that up to the user. So in case I didn't explain correctly, so the problem that I was having was that I was trying to put circles on, I was trying to create circles with all the points on the grid, but I was giving it less values of brightness because I had called the values of the brightness. So what I can do is I have to take the list of points. I have to call it also to remove the points from the list that have a small brightness, and then just draw here on the circle the ones that have the large brightness. Okay. All right. And I think that's it. That's all I wanted to do for this exercise. Now I can bake this, for example. I can use it at surfaces. And then I can now, I don't know, this is a shaded thing. I could use those circles for laser cutting. I could etch something. I could just put my face in the back of my laptop with the laser cutter. I don't know. There's a lot of things I could do. You could do with these kind of patterns right now. Okay. All right. So with that, I think we have completed the exercise. What was it? Like 7 components? This was really easy, actually, and very nice to work with. Wonderful. If you make some version of yourself using the technique, please share your work on the comments and or on our Discord server. We will be very happy to see it. We will be very happy to see it and to broadcast it. Okay. Thank you very much. If you like the video, maybe click on the like button, subscribe to the channel, all those things. And in the meantime, thank you very much and see you on the next video. Bye bye.